Hello students, welcome to the session of FMG CBT, and this is the subject pediatrics, and this is your pediatrics faculty Dr. Ashutosh Agarwal. I have taken 15 questions which is based on the most important topics which are asked in the FMG exam. So going on to the first topic, the child at birth appeared short. Out of the following, which child has the best prognosis for growth after birth? Right, a short stature is an important topic for FMG. So we are asking here, the child at birth appeared short, and out of the four categories, right? So if you see the first child born with Turner syndrome, the child is short at birth also, and the child is going to remain short in the adults also. Baby with birth length and weight is less than 10th percentile. They have only mentioned baby with birth length and weight. That means this child is having so-called head circumference is not affected. Only the length and the weight is affected. So this is particularly the asymmetrical IUGR. So if we consider the B choice is something which is the asymmetrical IUGR, which is also called head sparing IUGR. Then baby born to the parents who are themselves below the third percentile, that becomes a case of short stature. A familial short stature, genetic short stature. So if it is a genetic short stature, that means the child is going to remain short in the adult also. Here also the prognosis is not that so good. Baby with birth length, weight and head circumference is less than 10th percentile. So what it means is everything is being affected. So this is symmetrical IUGR. Symmetrical IUGR, right? So in the symmetrical, there is some problem in the first trimester, right? And if you compare both of them, asymmetrical and symmetrical, there are more chances of short stature in the symmetrical IUGR because the problem is in the first trimester when there is organogenesis. So if we consider here particularly least chances or the best prognosis out of the four choices being given is the choice number B here. That is particularly the B, asymmetrical IUGR, which is due to intrauterine hypoxia. The head circumference is particularly not affected there. So in this, it has got the good prognosis out of the four choices being given here. Moving on to the second question now. Child is diagnosed as having celiac disease. So celiac disease, again, an important topic for FMG exam. That is the gluten sensitive enteropathy. He is HLA DQ2 positive, which is positivity seen in the celiac disease, and there is also presence of anti-endomycial antibodies. So all of them are pointed in the favor of the celiac disease. Out of the following, which of the following statement is true? At birth, weight is less than expected. No, in a typical child of a celiac disease, the birth weight is normal, right? The problem starts after the 6 months, because in the first 6 months, you are going to give the child exclusive breastfeeds. So the problem will only arise after the 6 months when you will introduce the gluten in the diet. So weight gain falls after 6 months. Yes, this is something which is true. The linear growth velocity is not affected. No. Remember, in all malabsorption syndromes, both weight and length is affected. This is associated with megaloblastic anemia. Again, no. Why no? Because the celiac disease particularly affects the proximal part of intestine, and the most common part affected is the duodenum part. That is the duodenum. And in the duodenum, basically iron is absorbed. So this results in the iron deficiency anemia, which causes microcytic picture. This results in the iron deficiency anemia, which causes is the microcytic picture, right? So this is particularly regarding a case of the celiac disease. So remember the points here. So weight gain will usually start after 6 months when you will introduce the gluten in the diet, right? So moving on to the next one. Catch down growth. Although a new term may be for you, if you think of catch down growth, I have given the definition so called in the question only. involves a period of slow growth that follows a phase where baby experiences rapid or extreme growth above the normal range. The person was initially having more growth. The child was having more growth. Then the growth slowed down. Out of the following example of catch down growth is. Now if you can see the first choice, child losing weight in first 6 months of life due to bottle feeding. This is not catch down growth. Right? This is something the child is not gaining weight. That is there. The child was normal. Now the child is not gaining weight. Child is born as large for gestational age and now crosses to a lower centile line. Right? The child was above normal initially. Remember this. Child was above normal. Now he's become below normal. So this is perfect example of the catch down growth. Due to malabsorption, child is not gaining weight. This is something which you say failure to thrive, or the child is not gaining weight, but the child was normal. Due to growth hormone deficiency, there is decreased linear growth. This is again not catch down. Catch down growth means child was above normal initially and now he has become below normal. That is something which we say is the catch down growth. And out of the four example given, this is the perfect example of the catch down growth here. Moving on to the next one. 7-year-old child has history of recurrent wheeze and nocturnal cough. So if we just stop here, a child is having recurrent wheeze, nocturnal cough, our presumptive diagnosis can be bronchial asthma. That is something which is the bronchial asthma is. There is also family history of allergic rhinitis which supports the diagnosis of the bronchial asthma. Now out of this, which of the following statements is true? Now if you consider asthma, it is an obstruction. So obstruction means the expiratory phase will be prolonged, not the inspiratory phase. So this is absolutely wrong. Decrease in peak expiratory flow rate, absolutely right. There is decrease in the peak expiratory flow rate. And you should remember here, what is to be remembered, spirometry can be done in a child at or about the age of 6 years. Spirometry can be done at or about the age of 6 years. Mast cell stabilizers are not used in children. They are not used in children, so this is also wrong, right? So therefore, what is left now is the decrease in the peak expiratory flow rate. Out of this, that is the right answer among all of them. Right, now moving on to the next thing. At birth, in neonate screening for congenital heart disease is done. Which of the following statements is correct regarding congenital heart disease? Measurement of oxygen saturation can detect all congenital heart disease. No, it can detect many congenital heart disease, but it cannot detect all of the congenital heart disease. Normally, murmur can be present at birth due to patent ductus arteriosus, which disappears in 24 hours. So normally when a child is born, the ductus arteriosus is open. This ductus arteriosus has got the functional or physiological closure. That is the functional or the physiological closure within 24 hours. Right? So till the time this is patent, definitely we can get a murmur. So what we say? Normally, murmur can be present due to the patent ductus arteriosus that will disappear in 24 hours. Normal chest x-ray at birth excludes congenital heart disease. No, you study many of the, for example, boot shaped heart, figure of eight, right? That can mean supracardiac TAPVC, but they are not always present at birth. They might come at in 2 to 3 months. So this is not true. Babies having cyanotic congenital heart disease always appear blue at birth? No. They may appear later in the first week of life. Right? Maybe hypoplastic left heart syndrome. So out of this, these three statements are excluded. So what is left is the choice number B. Normally, murmur can be present at birth due to the patent ductus arteriosus, which disappears in 24 hours. Moving on to the next one. Child is having vomiting with no signs of dehydration, there is no fever and no history of diarrhea. Which of the following states is true regarding vomiting? So it's a simple question. We are asking you what can be seen in vomiting. vomiting can be a sign of increased intracranial pressure. Yes, that is a correct statement, but let us look at the other choices also. Projectile vomiting is diagnostic of pyloric stenosis. In pyloric stenosis, projectile vomiting is seen. That is true. But to say this is diagnostic, that is not true. So this is ruled out. Antibiotics are given in viral gastroenteritis. Remember, in viral gastroenteritis, normally there is no WBC and there is no blood in stool. So normally in the viral gastroenteritis, you are managing the dehydration part. You are not giving the antibiotics. This is ruled out. Presence of green colored vomiting in newborn is a sign of gastroesophageal reflex. No, that is a sign of intestinal obstruction. That is not a sign of particularly gastroesophageal reflex. This is ruled out. So this is the right answer. Even if you know the right answer, but my request to all of you is look at all the four choices. Read them. Maybe the first choice is right, but you should read all the four choices there. So we are going on to now question number 7. In a child diagnosed as VSD, there is presence of pan-systolic murmur at the lower left sternal border. In this child, there can be enlargement of all heart chambers except. Right? A simple question, because there are four chambers and the four choices has to come. So basically, examiner can easily frame a question. So let us consider this child is having like this VSD. And in VSD, what we expect is blood will flow from left ventricle to right ventricle. So when the blood goes from the left ventricle to right ventricle, and if the VSD is of large size, this right ventricle increases in size. Now from this, what can happen? The blood will go particularly to the lungs, to the pulmonary artery, and that will come back from the lungs. So what will happen? The left atrial size will increase. Now if the left atrial size will increase, because the blood is coming from the lungs, even the left ventricle size will increase. But in any case, right atrial size will not increase. And that is the basic differentiation between the ASD and the VSD. So if we consider here, the right answer should be the right atrium. In this child, there is enlargement of all the heart chambers except, and except is the right atrium. While evaluating for neurological disorder in children, which of the following is true? Delayed walking is always caused by muscle weakness. Muscle weakness can cause delayed walking, that is true. But delayed walking has got number of causes. It can be due to neuropathies. It can be due to skeletal problems. So this does not appear to be true. Cranial nerves can be checked only above 5 years of age. No. Cranial nerves can be checked by many things. They can be just looking at the angle of the mouth, by looking at the eyes, particularly in the facial nerve. So although some you can check only when the child is grown up, but this is also definitely not true. In spastic form of cerebral palsy, the plantar grasp persists more than normal. This is true, definitely. Because if in the body there is spasticity, the plantar grasp, which normally disappears by 9 to 12 months of age, that will persist more than normal. That will persist more than normal. Looking at the next one, Duchenne muscular dystrophy can affect both males and females. Duchenne is a X-linked recessive disorder. And if it is a X-linked recessive disorders, male will have the disease and females will be the carriers. So therefore, this statement does not hold true. So what is left is now, this statement holds true. In spastic form of cerebral palsy, the plantar grasp persists more than normal. This is the right statement which is here is. Right? So therefore, the right statement here is, out of these four, the three C choices there. Next one. Child is being assessed for motor development. Out of the following, which is a sign of abnormal gross motor development? Climbing upstairs and downstairs at 2 years of age. That is absolutely true. Child can go upstairs and downstairs, although it will be 2 feet per step, like this, 1, 1, 1, 1, or one step at a time. But this statement is true. Definitely it is true. Changing prone to supine position at 5 to 6 months of age. This appears when asymmetrical tonic neck reflex disappears. This appears when asymmetrical tonic neck reflex disappears. So therefore, definitely this statement is also true, that disappears at 5 to 6 months of age. That is true. crawling at the age of 18 months. No, the crawling should normally come at the age of 8 months, not at 18 months. So this is definitely not true. Pedaling a tricycle at the age of 3 years, absolutely is true. So we have asked you, out of the following, which is an abnormal gross motor development, that is crawling at the age of the 18 months is. Child is having weight for height less than minus 3 Z score. Now this is weight for height. So moment you say weight for height, that is a marker of acute malnutrition. That is a marker of acute malnutrition. So acute malnutrition is something which is wasting is. It is not stunting. So the choice this is ruled out. And the mid upper arm circumference is 11 centimeter. MUAC is 11 centimeter. That means less than 11.5. And they both are the marker of severe acute malnutrition. And SAM is really a topic for, important topic for FMG exam. The question has been asked on the mid upper arm circumference, the fluid of choice in severe dehydration in the SAM child, and you have been even asked on the vitamin A supplementation. So please remember, these are straightforward questions describing the criteria for the severe acute malnourished child. Right. Now to prevent the Down syndrome in child, screening test should be done in all pregnancy. That is the one line which you should remember. Should the screening test be done if the mother ages above? No, it should be done in all pregnancy. Now, which of the following is true regarding screening in the Down syndrome? This screening is done by the measurement of hormone and proteins in the maternal serum. Right? One thing, we look at the other choices. Done by measurement of hormones and proteins in the amniotic fluid? No. Although you measure alpha fetoprotein, right, that is the quad screening I am talking of, and the quad screening you are doing in the second trimester, right? So you are measuring alpha fetoprotein, you are measuring is unconjugated estriol, we are measuring is beta HCG, and we are measuring is inhibin. But where we are measuring? We are measuring in the maternal serum, not in the amniotic fluid. So therefore, this appears to be correct. If the risk ratio is 1 to 500, then termination of pregnancy is done? No. In fact, what is the criteria? If the risk ratio is 1 to 250, then confirmatory test is done. And the confirmatory either means amniocentesis or it means the chorionic villus sampling is. The couple with already child with Down syndrome, first screening is done in next pregnancy, you go for the direct confirmatory test. Right? If already there is a couple, they are having a child with Down syndrome, in the next pregnancy, we will not go for the screening, we will go for directly confirmation. Right? So these are the basically answers here. This appears incorrect. So the true statement goes in favor of done by the measurement of hormone and proteins in the maternal serum is. Regarding the inheritance of autosomal dominant disorders, which of the following is true? So if we, let us take autosomal dominant disorder, that means one parent is having the dominant gene. One parent. So this is, let us suppose, the dominant gene capital A. This is a diseased parent and this is the normal parent. So if you see in the next generation, this is like this. This is like this. This is like this. This is like this. So if you see what is the recurrence in the next generation, that is 50%. And if this person marries a normal person again, the same thing is going to be repeated. So what you normally say in the autosomal dominant disorder, usually one parent is affected. Usually one parent is affected. Then the important thing is, it will be seen in both males and females. So therefore, this statement holds not true. Males are affected more than females. No, that is seen in X-linked recessive disorder. Disease usually skips a generation? No. Normally, there is no skipping of generation. More common in cousin-cousin marriages? No. In cousin-cousin marriages, it is more chances of autosomal recessive. So, what of the statements is true? 50% of the offspring will be affected because the recurrence risk is 50%. The recurrence risk is how much? 50%. Term child was discharged 24 hours after birth. On day 3, parents notice yellowing of skin of face. Child is accepting feels well. Next step in this child is. Like whenever the child is there, you should always ask first about the feeding part. Why feeding part? Because you want to rule out the sepsis part. Because the child was discharged, child might have sepsis. But in the sepsis, the first thing you need to remember is the child will not feed well. The child is not able to tolerate feeds. So as the child is tolerating feeds, this is particularly ruled out. Sepsis screen, right? Then this is D3. And the D3, the child is having jaundice. That means total serum bilirubin should be more than 5 mg/dL. That should be there. Now, if this much is the jaundice, but D3, this can be physiological jaundice, right? They have not mentioned about the mother blood group, whether I should know there is any risk factor. Now, start phototherapy. How can I start phototherapy without knowing the bilirubin level? This does not hold true. Place the child in sunlight, nothing is going to happen, right? This is not true. So it's just an IQ type of a question. What should be measured? The bilirubin level should be measured. So we are going to measure here is first thing, that is the bilirubin level is. So you need to choose the answer depending upon the choices being given is. Moving on to the next one. 6 months old male child has history of increased sweating. That is one thing and is salty on kissing the child. 2 points. Make a diagnosis of what? Cystic fibrosis. There is cystic fibrosis, a classical thing, because there is increased sodium and chloride in sweat. So due to increased sodium and chloride in sweat, there will be particularly hyponatremia. There will be hyponatremia, not hypernatremia. It is definitely true. There is increased incidence of respiratory tract infection. There is decreased growth because there is fat malabsorption. Fat malabsorption as liver and pancreas are affected. Decreased serum cholesterol, that is also true. So out of the following, which is not true, that is the hypernatremia, that is not true. Right? So I try to make up certain new questions which based on the topics which are basically asked in FMG exams. The last one in this we take, a 4-year-old child has swelling all over the body, which is normal more in the morning and decreases till evening. In this child, the serum complement C3 level is normal, age is 4 years. Child is having swelling, decreases in the evening, most likely this is what we say is the nephrotic syndrome. This is the nephrotic syndrome. In the nephrotic syndrome, the most common age is minimal change disease. And minimal change disease, the age is 2 to 6 years of age. This is the most common age group of the minimal change disease. That is 2 to 6 years. Now, if you see what years they have given here, 4 years. This is particularly 2 to 6 years. And in the minimal change disease, the serum C3 level is normal. That is particularly given. So, what basically happens is there is proteinuria. So, due to that proteinuria, there will be decreased amount of albumin. So there will be basically hypoalbuminemia. There will be hypoalbuminemia. So if you consider here decreased serum bilirubin, that will be seen. Requires pneumococcal vaccination when in remission. The most common infection seen in nephrotic is Streptococcus pneumoniae, which can cause spontaneous bacterial peritonitis. Right? So what can basically happen is, in the nephrotic, there can be relapse. So in the relapse, again, there is increased incidence of infection. Which infection? Streptococcus pneumoniae. So this is something which is required. And in minimal change disease, what is to be done? Prednisone needs to be started. Renal biopsy at 4 years of age when serum C3 level is normal is not required. That is not required in minimal change disease. And you guys are having the question of nephrotic syndrome continuously in the last 3 exams. Right? So I've tried to sum up the most important questions for you for the FMG exams. All the very best. Happy studying from all the faculty of the DAMS. All the best. Thanks.